We are back on Taking Care of Business on Kern Radio News Talk 1180. In When the Game Was Ours, written in 2009, Larry Bird said, "People who have the least to do with the success of a team often have the most to say about it." Our next guest is the author of Don't Put Me In, Coach, My Incredible Journey from the End of the Bench to the End of the Bench, Mark Titus. Mark, welcome to Taking Care of Business.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Mark, I love your sense of humor.
I appreciate that.
Well, some of it's a little risque, you know, but it's
okay. Yeah, it is.
Yeah, we got to be careful with the risque on this show, but
I wrote the book. Yeah, I wrote the book for I would say 18 to 34 year old males, which I didn't really think out because that's the exact demographic that like brags that they don't like to read. You know, those are the guys that are like, I haven't read a book in 6 years, and I don't know if I should go get your book or not. And I'm thinking, why would I write a book for this demographic?
Right.
But anyway,
put it on tape.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, there you go. You can do that.
Yeah, I do a lot of books on tape. It would be great on tape. But, you know, Mark, I got to tell you, the praise from your teammates on the back of the book cover was just awe-inspiring. I mean, you know, some of this was just great. Mike Conley, who was the number 4 overall pick in the 2007 NBA draft, said, "I haven't read this book and probably never will, but the cover looks pretty cool, I guess."
Praise, huh?
Yeah, or Evan Turner was great, the number 2 overall pick in the 2010 NBA draft. "You want me to give you a quote for the book on the back of your, or for the back of your book? I guess I shouldn't be surprised. You've been riding my coattails for years. So, of course, you want me to put my name on your book to sell more copies."
Yep. Glowing praise for the book. Yeah, it makes the people want to go out and get it right now.
Huh? Or the best one was your coach. I love that. "Of all the players I've coached in my career, Mark Titus was one of them."
Yeah. Pretty good.
Well, you went from what, manager or ball boy to player?
Yeah. Pretty much. I was a manager. I went to Ohio State, and I'd been friends with Greg Oden and Mike Conley, both the guys you just mentioned. We're all from Indianapolis, and we're on the same AAU team. And those guys were big recruits for Ohio State. They were Greg especially was the number 1 recruit in the country, and I wasn't good enough to play at Ohio State or any big school for that matter, but I'd always wanted to go to a big school, not necessarily play basketball, just to go to college at a big school because that was my idea of what college was about. So my plan was always to go to big school. Those guys committed to Ohio State, and like Greg half jokingly said that I should come to Ohio State with him. And like as soon as he asked me, I was like, yeah, that sounds good. As if he was asking me to go out to lunch with him or something. You know, like I made this huge life decision in a split second. And I actually went to Ohio State before I even visited the campus. My first day on the campus was moving into my dorm, which looking back was probably a dumb thought process I had, but it turned out well for me. I used my connections with those guys to be a manager. The manager gig was terrible. It wasn't what I expected, so I quit. And then 2 weeks later, some guys had gotten hurt, and they didn't even have enough to scrimmage, so they asked me to come practice with the team. I thought it was going to be until those guys got healthy, but I must have done something right because I stretched it into 4 years.
Well, I got to tell you, the coach had another glowing comment about your managing ability. He said he's probably the worst manager we ever had.
Yeah, he did say that, and I would completely agree with him because I was kind of lied to by the coaches. The way they described the role of manager to me was that I would be in drills and practicing with the team a little bit, and they would like – pretty much the way they explained the role to me was they explained the walk-on role, but they titled it as a manager. So I was like, yeah, I'll sign up to be a manager. And I got there, and I was supposed to fill up water bottles and film practice and stuff, and I wasn't exactly enthusiastic about that because I kind of felt like I was lied to. But it's funny to look back on now, but at the time I was pretty mad. So I didn't exactly exert a lot of effort into my managing responsibilities.
Well, that was part of the walk-on. You get to walk the bottles and the basketballs onto the court.
Onto the court. There you go. Yeah, maybe that's what they meant.
Well, here, I read one story I read. It said, it's the last shot, 15 seconds to go. Coach draws up a play. You're the guy. What happened?
It was in practice, obviously. I mean, that would never happen in a game, but
well, I thought it was a game you put you in.
Oh yeah, that was an AAU game. I'm sorry. I was thinking into a practice at Ohio State.
The game.
Yeah. You're right. Hey, thanks for reminding me. I had the play drawn up for me. I'd sat on the bench the entire game, which I played on our AAU team. I actually did, and people don't believe that because I sat the bench at Ohio State, and then our AAU team had a bunch of NBA guys on it too, so people just assumed that I sat the bench there. But I actually played in a lot of games. But this particular game, we were playing a really athletic team, and I'm not very athletic, so it was just a bad matchup. So I knew I wasn't going to play. But anyway, I sat the bench the entire game. We were down by three with like 15 seconds left, and my coach puts me in, and I was kind of like freaking out because I hadn't played the entire game. And I wasn't loose, and I was kind of, you know, not really ready to play. But he puts me in, and I was like, well, it's okay. Maybe I'll just stand in the corner as the other guys shoot the game tying shot or whatever. But come to find out, I get in the huddle, and he draws up the play for me. And so I was pretty nervous because my role on the team was to be the designated three-point shooter, and since we were down by three, he wanted me to hit the three to send it to overtime. But one of my teammates ended up not following the play that was drawn up and just decided he'd just shoot the ball himself, and he pretty much airballed it and we lost. So that's the story. So
the coach had confidence in you, but obviously your other player
didn't. The player did it. Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
Our guest by phone is Mark Titus, author of Don't Put Me In, Coach, My Incredible NCAA Journey from the End of the Bench to the End of the Bench.
Hey, since you managed the bench at the end there, did you have a cushion you could sit on, or was it the hard bench?
Yeah, we had the padded seats, which is great. I mean, some of the places we played on the road, they wouldn't take care of us, and we had to sit on just the hard wooden bench, and that was awful. That was the worst. But, Ohio State, yeah, they do it big over there. They get nice seats. And if they wouldn't have, I would have definitely been in the athletic director's office demanding it.
Definitely. How did Ohio State do in the years you were there?
Oh, that's funny you ask, because, I mean, I graduated actually as the all-time winningest player in Ohio State history.
Wow.
And that's a fact. No Ohio State player won more games than I did, and I had pretty much nothing to do with any of them. But anyway, the point is that, like, I was on a lot of great teams. We had a lot of great players. And my freshman year, we went to the Final Four and lost in the national championship game to Florida. The next year, we went to the NIT, which is the lesser of the two tournaments. Not exactly the tournament you want to be in, but ended up winning the NIT, which is like, you know,
65th place.
Yeah, the best loser or whatever you want to say. Yeah. The next year was kind of a lost year. We made the NCAA tournament, but lost in the first round. And then my senior year was we made it to the Sweet 16 in the NCAA tournament. Had a pretty good year, and Evan Turner, one of my teammates, was the National Player of the Year. And so, I mean, I ended up playing with like 8 or 9 NBA players, and
seven
Evan was
All-Americans.
National Player of the Year. Greg was the number one pick. Mike was top 5 pick. So, I mean, I had a lot of good players, a lot of good teams.
You know, there was an interview that I saw you had on YouTube that cracked me up. You were talking, I guess it was your sophomore year, and you started out by telling them, I'm going to make an announcement here that I'm not going to declare for the NBA draft.
Yeah, that was a pep rally held at Ohio State after we went to the Final Four and lost in the national championship game. We had a pep rally to celebrate. Like, we had a really good season, and even though we lost, like, all the fans were excited, and it was still a good run we had and all that. So we had a pep rally in the gym, and when the team came out, the fans started chanting one more year because we had Greg and Mike and a couple other guys who could have gone to the NBA and actually did end up going to the NBA, could have left school early and gone to the NBA. And so they chanted one more year to try to persuade those guys to stay another year, but they obviously didn't say, like, hey, Greg, one more year. They just started chanting one more year over and over and didn't really say who they were chanting it to, even though everyone knew who it was. So when it became my time to do the interview, we did like a little interview portion. When it came my time to do the interview, I grabbed the mic and I said, hey, listen, I hear you guys chanting one more year, and just relax. I'm going to come back. Don't worry about it.
Somebody to ride that bench.
Yeah.
There was another story you had about I guess it was the championship game, and there's a couple minutes left, and you walk up to the coach and said something about your 5 fouls. Do you remember that story?
Yeah, that's true. That's a true story. People think I made that up. But, yeah, we were about the national championship was about to tip off, and we broke the huddle, and all the players, the starters, walked out onto the floor, and I was supposed to walk back to the bench. But on the way back to the bench, I stopped and walked up to my head coach, Coach Mata, Thad Mata, and I said, Coach, listen, I get 5 fouls just like all these other players. So if you want me to go in there and injure a guy on the other team or rough him up a little bit, I can just foul out and come back and sit right back on the bench. And I said, I can't take him with me, so I might as well use him, right? Otherwise, they're just going to go to waste. And he got a good laugh out of that, and then he's like, go sit down, we're about to play, and all that.
I remember I used to play with the girls. I'd fall out all the time.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Now, see, you're talking to two guys, by the way, who played in high school. I'm 5'8". I think I was 140 pounds in high school, so
wow.
I wasn't going to go anywhere as a player. But when we come back, I want to talk to you a little bit about what you're doing now. We'll be back in a moment on Taking Care of Business on Kern Radio News Talk 1180.